It's my pleasure to welcome Antoni Rangachev of Northeastern University, who will speak to us today about restricted local volumes and deformation theory.
Oh, thank you, David. It's a pleasure to be here. I remember the days when I was undergraduate and I would come to listen to the talks at the Worldwide Center. And now it's I finally have the opportunity to join the team of speakers. So before going into details, I would like to point out that there are three relevant talks given here at the Worldwide Center to what I'm going to speak about today. So there are two talks on equisingularity theory given by Professor Kleiman and Professor Le. And there is one talk given last year by Mikhail Fugger, maybe early 2016. Yeah. So I'll build on these talks in a way. What I'm going to talk about today is a far-reaching generalization of the notion of multiplicity. And I'm going to talk about how this far-reaching generalization of this notion of multiplicity behaves in families. So I'm going to be interested in the change of this invariant across families. So it looks like that the first results of this type are due to Hironaka in the late 50s. I'll just mention one of those results that you're all familiar with. So Hironaka proved that a family of projective schemes is flat over a irreducible reduced base is flat if and only if the Hilbert polynomial is constant. So that's an old result that goes back to Hironaka. And then there is a local part of this result in the late 60s. But before going into details, let me start with an example that you're all familiar with. So let's look at the singularity's favorite example. Let me see if I can draw it. So this is that's a beautiful. Yeah. Oh, thank you. So algebraically, this is given by this equation. So this is the example of a node deforming into a cusp, and we would like to understand if this family of curves is in some sense, equisingular. So how do we do that? Well, one notion of equisingularity is Whitney equisingularity. I'm not going to define what Whitney equisingularity is, so you can refer to these previous talks. But numerically, there is a way to detect that, whether the family is equisingular, just by looking at fiberwise invariants. So the theorems that like the results that control, that give numerical control of the Whitney equisingularity of this type. So Whitney equisingularity holds if and only if certain invariants remain constant along the fibers. So we can look at the Jacobian idea with respect to the fiber coordinates.
You're thinking of a family. Y, right?
Yeah. Y is the parameter axis, yeah. And we can take the blow up of x with respect to this ideal.
You haven't called anything.
What's that?
You haven't called anything.
Well, x will be the total space. X is the total space. That's the total space. All right, so So this will be the object that will control Whitney-Equis singularity. More precisely, it will be the exceptional divisor. So we'll be interested in the behavior of the exceptional divisor. So if you actually look at this object, it's the blow-up of J sub y, x sub y. So J sub y is the image of J in all x sub y. So this gives you the Nash blob. So here we have an exceptional divisor. Okay, so it's just in this case it's a bunch of points. And so
at the origin.
Yeah. So this is
at the origin of the fiber.
At the origin of the fiber, at the singular point of the fiber. That's what we're looking at. So this is the closure of this set. So this is a smooth point and the tangent plane next to it, and we close this up. So what we're interested now is at the exceptional divisor over Y. So you would expect, if things behave nicely, that this is the same thing as the exceptional divisor of the blow-up on the fiber, okay? So the restriction of the exceptional divisor on the fiber, you would expect it to be equal to the exceptional divisor of the blow-up on the fiber. Well, that's the case if Y is generic. But what can happen if you look at, let's denote this point by Y naught, the close point here. So what can happen is that you might have some vertical components. You might have a component of the exceptional divisor that surjects onto Y naught. And so this is the obstruction to equisingularity, to Whitney's equisingularity. So this is the, it follows from the algebraic theory as developed by Le and Tessier. So now the question is, how do we capture numerically the presence of these vertical components? Well, the answer to this question is, you can look at the Hilbert-Samel multiplicity of this ideal, J sub y, and you can look at what happens on the closed fiber, and you can look at what happens at the generic fiber. So by a key result, well, I mean, it's usually attributed to Ramanujam. Maybe it was known before him. So this is equal to the degree of the exceptional divisor on the closed fiber, and this is equal to the degree of the exceptional divisor on the generic fiber. And so you can look at the difference of these multiplicities. And, well, in this case, in this particular case, what it happens is you get 3 here. So you get a double point and a point. And here you get 2. So for the difference, you get 1. And it's a result that goes back to Tessier. I'm about to state it formally, that in fact, always this difference of Hilbert sum of multiplicities gives you the degree of these vertical components. So this is how you capture numerically the presence of the obstruction to Whitney equisingularity. And my talk will be about a far-reaching generalization of this result. So here, let me write Tessier's result. So if we have a family, so assume that it's a flat family, well, over one-dimensional base space, assume that the fibers are of dimension R, and we have an ideal sheaf such that the support of the quotient is finite over Y. Then, so also look at the blow up of X with respect to I, with center I. Then Tessier's result is that the difference of these multiplicities Hilbert sum of multiplicity is precisely the degree of this vertical components that sit at the. So this will be the dimension R vertical components of the exceptional divisor that's reject onto X naught. Or another way to write Tessier's result. So I so far I didn't say anything about the Hilbert sum of multiplicity, but algebraically you can define it in terms of limits. So this multiplicities appear as leading coefficients, as normalized leading coefficients of a Hilbert polynomial. So you can define it in this way. Well, this is the residue field of Y naught. It's the same thing. All right. So this is more algebraic way of stating the result. And there is a significant generalization of this result by Gaffney. So he calls it the multiplicity power theorem. For the Buchs-Baum-Rim multiplicity. So he was inspired by Tessier's result and considered the equivalent, well, the version of this statement for the Buchs-Baum-Rim multiplicity, which is generalization of the Hilbert sum of multiplicities from ideals to modules. And my main inspiration was Gaffney's work. He applied his result to numerous problems from equisingularity and deformation theory and topology of singularities. So especially in singularity theory, this kind of result is it's a very, very important. And that's what he demonstrated. So as a result, it really gives you the required machinery to study singularities, mostly isolated, but not only isolated singularities of a particular type, either complete intersection singularities or smoothable singularities. But when you move to the more general case, you need generalization of Gaffney's result. And I'm going to state it here.
I want to put the parenthesis outside the tensor product, because that's the length of the tensor product, not the tensor product.
That's right.
And the second parenthesis.
Okay.
I don't know.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's the length of... Oh, yeah. I see what you're saying. Is that okay? Okay. All right. So here is the setup. So we look at a flat family . So we assume that X is equidimensional, and here we look at Z, it's an OX projective scheme given by approach of an algebra, a finitely generated graded OX algebra. And we'll assume that this is also equidimensional. And here I'll look at S, which is a subscheme of X such that it's finite over Y. And all these objects are of finite type over a field. So X and Y are finite type over a field such that the residue fields of X naught and Y naught are the same. So this is the assumption. And so I'll call this, so let me throw some more notation. So this morphism from Z to X will be denoted by G, and this one by F. And so assume that the composition of these morphisms from the morphism from Z to Y has, so the fibers are of dimension R. And finally, if we look at G inverse X naught, which is the fiber over the close point here, by this, by bracket sub R, we denote the dimension R part of the fundamental cycle. So it's the dimension R part of the fundamental cycle of G inverse X naught. Okay, so I have everything to state the main result. So what you can do is you can look at local cohomology with support at S of the various graded pieces of A, and you can look at the restriction of this local cohomology modules to the fibers,
and look, you can look at the dimension.
Well, you would expect in some nice situations like this one that when you go to n large enough that this will behave as polynomials. That's not the case. But if you normalize by this fraction and take limits to infinity, this turns out to be well behaved. So we did this construction on the closed fiber. Now we can do it on the generic fiber. And the question is, what do we get when we take the difference? So in a moment, I'll say something about this type of
function. Subscript on A, is that an N?
N, that's an N. And that's an N here.
So how should I think of this local cohomology in what sense? I mean, S is a...
Yeah.
A sub n is just a credit piece, right?
Yeah, it's a module. It's an OX module.
Each graded piece?
Yeah, each graded piece is an OX module.
And then you will localize
it? Yeah, I work locally at X, and I look at the local cohomology with support at S. Yeah, so, the way it's phrased, unfortunately, I'm phrasing it in the most general form, but I'll say why it recovers all these previous cases.
And this cohomology as an object is what the vector space. What is it?
This is a vector space, a finite dimension.
Over what field?
Over the residue field of why not and over the yeah the. No, you have to restrict H1 to the fiber, and that's a finite vector dimension. Otherwise, on the total space, it's of infinite vector dimension.
Again, it's got big parentheses around the thing. Yeah. And I need to put some parentheses. It's not clear what you know.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, one more time. H1 of A and sub S, this local cohomology is a K of Y0 vector space?
Yes.
No, before you tensor. You're asking about before you tensor.
Oh, before? No.
So then what do you tensor over?
So this is an OY module.
So the tensor of
OY? Yeah.
Why don't you write it? Otherwise, the default value is C.
Okay. All right. So the question now is, what do you get when you take this difference? And you get the same result as Tessier and Gaffney did. So it's this degree of G inverse X naught of this top dimensional part of the fundamental cycle. So yeah, and this is a generalization of all these previous results. And this invariant, it's well studied. These kind of invariants are well studied in birational geometry. So when I showed this to Professor Lazarsfeld, he immediately said, "Well, that's the restricted volume." We knew about this kind of invariants also from commutative algebra. From that side, they're called epsilon multiplicities. And there is a lot of work done by Ulrich, Validashti, and Kleiman there. From the perspective of birational geometry, these are certain types of volumes. Well, it's not the restricted volume as studied by Ein, Lazarsfeld, Mustatza, Nakama, and Popa. It's the local counterpart of it. So here I refer to Mihai Stock from last semester when he defined local volumes. It's a generalization of his construction.
So implicit in this assertion is that this limit exists?
Yes, that's one of the big theorems. It's not implicit at all. Usually these are limb soups. And it's a theorem to prove that the limb soup is a limit. Yeah, so these are, so yeah, maybe I should mention here that, yeah, it was, so the limits exist by results of Kutkowski, who built on results of Okunkov, Lazarsfeld, Mostatsa. I cannot write this T right now, but yeah. You can, is it Mostatsa? That's the right pronunciation, right? And Kavehin-Kuvansky. And that's actually an essential part in the proof that I use, that the limit exists. Otherwise, if you work with limb soups, you don't get anything. So why is it a volume type invariant? Maybe I can briefly mention why that this is the case. So usually the way you interpret this as a volume is you look at some compactification, projective extension of X, and you also look at some modification of Z, and there you associate a line bundle that you construct from A, and you in a sense compactify the situation, and that's how you make an interpretation. This is the classical volume of a line bundle, and the volume of a line bundle classically, so I'll just mention it here. So if Z is projective irreducible of dimension R, then this is defined as the volume of the line bundle. And in some cases, particularly nice cases when L is nef, and L is it's a line bundle on X. So this is simply the top self-intersection number. And if Z is smooth and L is ample, this is the volume of X with respect to the Keller metric represented by the first Schoen class of L. So this is that's why this is referred as a volume. The volume of G? No. The volume of, oh, it's Z, I'm sorry. Yeah, there's no X, it's Z. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. All right, so. This volume? No, the R is the dimension of Z, and L is, yeah. Yeah, R is the dimension of Z, and maybe I define it somewhere
it's,
here.
It's there, right? Although where you wrote volume Z.
Right,
you
yeah.
You wrote it right there. Z is projective
irreducible. Of dimension R, yeah. Right. All right, so. Well, let me just briefly mention that this kind of result has, like, I'm about to go to the applications now, but presumably it will have also applications to, problems that are related to simultaneous existence of canonical models, problems appearing from, moduli theory. I'm going to focus on applications to deformation theory, applications we already know about.
Can I ask you just a quick question also? Do you get into mixed volumes?
No. I don't know about this. I'm not going into mixed volumes.
Are those involved other kind of polynomials in the joint classes?
The mixed volumes?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm not able to speak about this. I'm not familiar with that theory. No, he talked about local volumes. I don't remember him talking about. All right, so. So let me so mention one problem. So this invariance, so it's a restricted, it's a restricted local volume, which means that, well, it's, we have an object on the total space and we restrict it to the fibers, but ideally we would like an invariant that depends only on the fibers. So there is this problem of specialization. Okay, so this in this part specializes nicely always, but this one may not specialize. So what I mean here is that if you vary, like if you start with the closed fiber here, and you look at different one-parameter deformations, for each one of them you might get a different invariant. And this is not a nice situation. And in fact, you can get infinitely many of those. So it's not a nice situation, and we want to avoid this. So, but before going into that, let me give you another interpretation of this degree. It's when we look at particularly nice situation when the fiber over the generic point of each irreducible component of X is a projective space. So here is the picture. So here, well, up here, we are in X cross some projective space. So that's where Z lives. And like imagine that, well, what I drew here represents G inverse X naught, the r-dimensional part of this fiber. So, and here, down here, this is X, and this is X naught, and here we have Y, the parameter space. So, how can we interpret this degree? Well, if we intersect Z with a hyperplane of the right codimension, with a generic hyperplane of the right codimension, well, then using Kleinmann's transversality result, what we get in this particularly nice situation is we get the degree, so we get some points here sitting on over X naught, and that's the degree of this component here, but also in terms of the total space now, when we project down to X naught, and when we look at this as covering over Y naught, off Y naught, it's a covering. So then this degree we can interpret in the family setting as the degree of this covering over Y. So here. So I mean, in general, this is not a covering, so there are like multiplicities up here. There's ramification points. But in this particularly nice situation, you can select such a hyperplane that gives you this interpretation of the degree. Well, that's very, very useful. Now I'll draw another picture. So I'll erase this part. So So we'll be using this interpretation when we move to some larger deformation spaces. So let me first define. So now, instead of y is regular of dimension 1, I'll think of y as a curve embedded in a larger deformation space, w. So w is, so we'll say that w is a good deformation space. For the closed fiber, if this invariant, so actually let me denote this by abusive notation. This is not how it should be denoted, but just for the purposes of this talk, let me denote this as vo of x, y naught and vo of x, y. So we'll say that W is a good deformation space if the fiber over generic W, so W is in some Zariski open subset of W, if this volume is constant. So if there is some stabilization, well, there, in the very general case, in birational theory, when you look at arbitrary line bundles, there are examples where you cannot expect even the existence of such deformation spaces. It's like there the volume can behave very in a very unpredictable way. Something that I actually forgot to mention is that this invariant can be a rational number. So there is a construction due to Kutkowski where this is actually an irrational number. And what this result shows in this case is that the irrational part cancels out in the difference. But when the volume is an irrational number, I mean, it's when it doesn't have this nice intersection theoretic proper description, it might be the case that such spaces do not exist for very general X and A, very general A. But assume that that's the case, that they exist. And in fact, when we apply this assumption to a deformation theory of singularities, it will turn out that it leads to new results that generalize previous results. Well, it's always upper semi-continuous, but it's not clear if it's a risky upper semi-continuous. Well, that's right. That if it's constant, yeah, that's what it tells you. Yeah. All right, so now let me draw a picture here.
Okay, I'm sorry. I need to ask one.
Yeah.
So you would think if you really want Zariski upper semi-continuity, that it's not enough for it to be constant on a generic set, but then on the non-generic set, well, it really needs to give you a stratification. There needs to be a nice locally finite sort of stratification where it's constant on all of the strata. It might jump up, but it doesn't do it on weird sets. Do you want that, or is this enough?
Well, I'm looking at, maybe I didn't say that W is irreducible here. Irreducible.
Yeah.
Well, you would expect, if it's a risky upper semi-continuity, you would expect that there is a Zariski open subset where the volume is constant.
Yeah.
This is what I mean here.
I understand that's what you mean there, but you could ask for
more?
A seemingly stronger condition that normally when you have upper semi-continuity, it's okay, fine. It's constant on the Zariski open set. But then it jumps up on what's a closed set, which would be a smaller dimension. But then you'd want to know that on kind of a generic set of that smaller set, it's constant again.
Yeah.
This doesn't imply that, right?
I don't think so. Yeah. So let me draw a picture here. So this is W, and imagine that we are our original family Y is embedded here. So this is W. And now I want to address this issue of specialization. So the problem is that if I look at families, one parameter families that line such that their base space is line W, then this is not well defined, this invariant. Like for any such deformation, I get a new invariant, which is a problem. What this hypothesis actually helps us to see is that this can be this issue can be settled when we work over good deformation space, and it's actually an argument that you can find in our joint with my joint paper with Gaffney. It's on a deformation theory of determinant of singularities, but there we state this general result. So it's again a covering argument. So let's say you look at one parameter deformation. So this is y naught, and this is some generic y. And here I didn't say it, but from arbitrary k, I move to the complex numbers. Okay, so I'm in the complex analytic setting. So we have two curves, two deformations. So we deform the closed fiber of the original family over a curve here, some generic deformation, and I do the same thing for the generic fiber here. And now, for these deformations, I can compute these volumes for this fiber and for this fiber. And actually, because of this argument, this covering argument, everything can be represented by a cover of W. So the picture looks like this. So here, what you get is you get degree 3 over this one parameter deformation. Here, what you get is degree 1. And the degree for this family, the initial family that we were interested in, is 2. So what this tells us is that, so if we look at the volume of the original closed fiber, and we look at, we apply this formula for this deformation, one parameter deformation over W1, let's say we code this degree by D1, and this degree here will be D2, and this one here will be D3. So I apply now the formula for this one parameter deformation. And I take the difference. So the key observation here is that if these are generic curves, these two volumes will be the same, because by assumption, we're over good deformation space. So what we get is the difference of the two volumes that we computed from these one parameter deformations is equal to the difference of D1 and D2, but by this covering argument, we see that this difference is always equal to this d3 that we get as the degree that we associate to this to the original family. So, and this tells us that we have unique objects. To every fiber, we compute the volume as the volume from a generic one-parameter deformation. So that issue of specialization is not an issue when we work over good deformation space. So now let me go, in the remaining 15 minutes, let me discuss applications to singularity theory. So this is a description of the, so general description of the machinery. So far I haven't mentioned singularities at all, maybe just in the introduction, but it does not, we do not assume that we work with singular spaces. Oh, well, yeah, well, in this picture, it's 3, 2, and 1, right? But so D1 is this degree that we get over the one parameter deformation. And this is, D2 is this degree that we get over this parameter deformation. And D3 is this degree that we get over the original family. And it's a result that these D1, D2, and D3 are related in this way. D1 minus D2 is equal to D3.
Oh, okay.
That's what the bar means, yeah. That's, I have to put the minus sign here. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let me move to applications, to singularity theory. And let me define the algebraic objects that we'll be interested in. So this is applications. So we work with a family. So it's total space. Let's assume that we work over one parameter with one parameter families, but it doesn't have to be. Okay, well, it really doesn't have to. So let's put some CK. And there is a section here, sigma. So in this sigma y, the sigma y will be our S. So it's this S here, which in the applications is, it's just an axis of singularities. When we look at isolated, for example, singularities, this will be an axis of I have to say it's a component of the set of the singular locus. Okay. All right. So what is the algebraic object that we'll be looking at? What is Z? So Z is the object that will control equisingularity conditions.
I'm sorry, you may have said it. Dimension of y, k?
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, let's assume that x is cut out by number of equations. And we look at the object that we'll be looking at is the Jacobian module. So with respect to partials with the fiber coordinates. So, okay, what is this? This is the Jacobian matrix. But it really, you can give it a module structure, an OX module structure. So it sits inside the free module of rank L, where L is the number of equations. And the columns of this matrix, they generate a module over O of X. So I'll denote this module by A, or it will be my A1. And now you can look at the Ries algebra of this module, and I'll explain in a second why do we need to do that. So there is algebra. So this is simply, in this case, it's a graded algebra generated in degree one. And the graded pieces of this algebra are, so the nth graded piece, the nth graded piece is simply the symmetric algebra, the nth symmetric algebra, V1, modulo x torsion. This is how we'll define the Riesz algebra here. I mean, it has an intrinsic definition that does not require the embedding of the free module, but for our purposes, we can work with this definition. It starts with degree zero. It's an OX algebra generated in degree one. Okay, so this algebra has a particular meaning in singularity theory because the approach of this Riesz algebra, it gives you the conormal space. So we look at pairs of X is a smooth point, and H is a hyperplane in CN that contains the tangent space. And we close this up. So this is the conormal space, and it has this is usually denoted by C of X, very particular meaning. It's important to equisingularity theory. I will loosely state the Whitney equisingularity and what it's equivalent to, what's its algebraic formulation. So loosely speaking, C of X is equidimensional along Y, if and only if the family is Whitney equisingular. I mean, here, if you work with Whitney B, you have to take the Jacobian module times the maximal ideal of the germ and so on. And so basically that will correspond to the blow-up of the usual conormal space with respect to the axis of singularities. But like loosely speaking, what we are concerned is we have an object Z, and we try to see if it behaves well along Y. So bad things happen when there is something where there is a component of the inverse image of Y in C of X, which is supported over the origin, over the closed fiber. So for the case of hypersurfaces,
did you say that was Tessier?
Where?
That result.
This result, I didn't say that. I think this algebraic characterization goes to Tessier. Lem might be also there. So yes, this is an old result. I hope they don't. it's relativistic. So if we have a family of hypersurfaces, so Tessier used the Hubert Samuel multiplicity to control the Whitney equisingularity. In the case when X is a complete intersection or families of isolated complete intersection singularities. We usually denote them by ICs, but maybe we have to change this notation. So, of course, here I also meant isolated hypersurface singularities. So the numerical control is done by Buxbaum-Rim multiplicity, and it's three invenciones papers by Gaffney, and the last one with Kleiman. So this is the Buxbaum-Rim multiplicity provides this numerical control. And so when X is mutable, a lot of these mutable singularities, you can use Gaffney's multiplicity power theorem. And this is what he does, multiplicity power theorem. And here I'll mention our joint paper for determinantal singularities. The determinantal singularities are natural generalization of complete intersection singularities. So for determinantal singularities, it was by Gaffney and myself. But the question is, what do you do if you work with more general singularities? And even not, so I didn't mention here, but most of these results extend to families of non-isolated singularities. More care has to be taken. But let's just assume for now that we work with families of isolated singularities.
That result about equidimensionality along Y.
Yeah.
X is completely equidistant. That didn't require isolated singularities.
No. No, no, no. Yeah.
Just maybe in the word, can you say what's a determinantal singularity? The same thing as a determinantal variety? Or?
No, it's determinantal singularities.
Okay, so what's the difference?
Well, determinantal singularities are defined by determinants, yeah. The critical.
There's a matrix that controls the whole thing?
You take a matrix of polynomials.
Yeah, polynomials.
And then, yeah, it's controlled by the minors, the vanishing of the minors.
Yeah.
Determinantal, yeah, but...
No one cares about the ones that are singular.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so...
Is the equidimensionality there? The hypothesis on the blowout of the conormal on the inverse image?
Oh, along the inverse image of Y in the conormal.
Yeah, you blow it up and take the exceptional
device. That's right. This is Whitney B. Yeah. This is what controls Whitney B.
But here this is...
Whitney A. Yeah, I'm speaking loosely because if I give you all the details, it will require another talk. Just to give you an intuition about the algebraic object that controls Whitney equisingularity. It's a modification of the conormal space. All right. So let me in the last, in the remaining 10 minutes, discuss the extension of this work to more general singularities.
Maybe it's a language problem. 2 and 10 are not the same words.
Well, on the other hand, you gave me such a hard time with questions here, so you can stay.
That never happens.
Never happens. It's just me. For some reason, I triggered this discussion. Anyway, so what I'm going to speak now about is the class of singularities that not necessarily admit, that are not necessarily smoothable. And from this class, I'll be interested in a subclass of these singularities, and this is the class of singularities, class of isolated singularities. That admit good deformation space. With respect to the volume. So here we specialize the volume. This Z now is the conormal. So yeah, this is a particular instance of this construction with respect to the volume function. So admit a good deformation space, let's call it W, with respect to the volume. Well, this class includes the class of all smoothable singularities. And for this class, if you consider a smoothing of a singularity and if you evaluate the volume, the smoothing, it's trivially zero. So for smoothable, the volume. So again, here is the setup. So we look at some large deformation space W, and if X W is smoothable, then the volume is zero. So this is first class. Then there is another class. If XW is rigid, it means that all deformations of XW are trivial. So then the volume is trivially constant in a small neighborhood of this little W. So in fact, it might be the case that it's zero always, but I'm not sure about this one. It's a conjecture. And the third class that we can look at is that we know that the volume will be zero. It's a class that I introduced. It's the class of deficient conormal singularities. So now I'll say what that is. So for this singularities, the volume vanishes. So here, XW is a deficient conormal singularity. So we look at all singularities, isolated singularities, that admit a deformation to a deficient conormal singularity. And if that's the case, if the generic fiber of such deformation is a deficient conormal singularity, then the volume vanishes, it stabilizes, and the machinery works nicely. So let me just say in conclusion what a deficient conormal singularity is. So say X is embedded in Cn, well then if you look at the conormal space of X, as I defined it a moment ago, and if you look at the fiber of this conormal space over the origin, over the singular point, you would expect that, in general, the codimension of this fiber in C of X is 1. So that's what happens in general, but a deficient conormal singularity, as the name suggests, is a singularity for which the codimension is at least 2. And apparently, well, this class, of course, it contains the class of all smooth, well, yeah, a smooth object is a deficient conormal singularity. Let's put it this way. In my opinion, most rigid singularities are deficient conormal singularities. If you look at Schlesinger's list of rigid singularities, you can see that most of the examples he lists are deficient conormal singularities. Whether everything that's rigid is deficient is unclear to me. But for this class, for this large class, and apparently the class is large, because there is this recent paper due to Gaffney and Ruas where they look at essentially isolated determinant of singularities. And this class of singularities, they admit deformations to deficient conormal singularities. So most of the, we expect that most of the determinant of singularities will be, will admit deformations to deficient conormal singularities. And in general, even for determinant of singularities, it's not clear whether they're smoothable. It's clear if they're of dimension less than 5,
so
I think.
If smooth spaces are
deficient. Macaulay codimension 2, dimension less than 5, I think there is this result of Shams that tells me that they're smoothable. But in general, it's not clear.
Yeah. If all smooth spaces are deficient, then the way in which they're deficient being really singular. Right? I mean, you're deficient means they're missing something. They're missing being really singular.
But
if you're, I mean, if a smooth thing is deficient, the question is, should I view that intuitively, geometrically, as saying the way in which it's deficient being very singular. It's not so singular.
That's the idea, that when you look at this generic deformations, you get something nicer. Well, not maybe not as nice as something that's smooth, but something close enough. And there is a procedure actually described by Kleiman and Torup how to get these deficient conormal singularities. You start with a projective variety with the deficient dual, and if you look at the cone over a deaffine cone, that procedure gives you a deficient conormal singularity at the vertex of the cone. So, yeah. But whether all these singularities are cone-type singularities, it's not clear. Okay. With this, I'll conclude. Thank you.
Well, thank you.